countries where there were extraordinary ancient cities such as or the monuments. So there seems to me there's always a particular a way of looking at things that inspires a new kind of tourism, ecotourism, archaeological tourism, tourism to study trees, to study botany, as many things as there are to learn about. That's another style of tourism, basically.
You actually touched on something that I wanted to ask you a little bit more about, because you cast Marlon Brando in the Godfather series, in Apocalypse Now. Most people don't know that, and I certainly didn't, that Marlon Brando was an early visionary for what we call sustainable travel. He talked about wanting to create a resort on his beloved Tetiaro Island in Tahiti that would protect Polynesian heritage, that would demonstrate sustainable technologies, that would help save nature. He didn't live long enough to see that resort created, but it is today the Brando 4 years ago. But most people also don't know that you created one of the world's earliest eco-resorts. You were just talking about it in Belize. It put you on the cover of National Geographic, Best Eco-Lodges in the World. And yet, that was, as you said, in the early 1980s. In fact, the term ecotourism didn't even exist at that time. And Blancano Resort in Belize, you grow your food organically, you're 100% renewable energy, and this has been happening since the 1980s. So my question is it just a coincidence that you and Marlon ended up doing these things? Did you ever talk about this on the set? You both became pioneers in sustainable eco-travel.
Well, first to talk about Marlon a second. Aside from his, of course, great importance as an actor and the influence he had on so many generations, subsequent generations of actors, Marlon was really, beyond that part of him, one of the few geniuses I've ever met. And by that I mean the way he thought. You could have the most extraordinary conversations or most of it would be listening to him talking about termites or talking about what it might have been like for the Chinese who first came to the United States to build the railroads. He had a very unique mind, and his mind could get lost in a subject and where he would just talk about it and go on. It was difficult working with him as an actor because, like anyone, he of course often was stalling before we all had to get to work. And when he first showed up for Apocalypse Now, we were in a houseboat a trailer kind of where we were supposed to talk a little bit and then go shoot. But he would start talking about the most fascinating stuff, and before I know it, half the day was gone. I only had 3 weeks. I had $1 million a week. I had it for 3 weeks. And he would start talking about these interesting subjects. It would go on and on, and then they'd knock on the door. What should we do? Should we break for lunch? And I said, well, yeah, break for lunch. And then 3 hours later, they would knock on the door. What should we do? Should we send everyone home? And I said, yeah, send everyone home. Because to listen to him talk about interesting subject matter was just fascinating. And indeed, when he made the film Mutiny on the Bounty, he fell in love with Polynesia and with a wife that he married her, and he bought in Polynesia an atoll. It's not really an island. It's a system of islands called Pitaroa. And he always talked about it. He loved this. For a while, he even had a little shack there, and he would live on it, even like a native and what have you. And he always had the dream of making Pitaroa into some sort of very advanced eco-lodge, which they did. He did it in partnership, I think, with a guy named Williams.
Yes.
And apparently, it's very successful. Not only for the visitors, I understand President Obama went there to
work on his memoirs.
Work on his memoirs, but also that he has scientists studying the various possible things to study in Polynesia, and it's a model of what we're talking about, which is where tourism doesn't erode and destroy what the people have come to see, but in some way helps sustain it. So that is an example of I have not been there myself, although only recently I learned more about it. I would love to go to Polynesia. I would love to see it. But indeed, when British Honduras became the lease in 1981, it did so under the very enlightened guidance of George Price, who was the first prime minister, and his associates, and it was founded as an eco preserve. The entire country was very careful to preserve mangrove, to preserve species, to preserve all that was natural in Belize. And in fact, at that time, some of you may remember, there was an American industrialist, I think his name was Ludwig. You remember the episode of Ludwig?
Yes.
Who had a ton of money and wanted to build a big, almost a city in some primitive setting to do logging or stuff. And ultimately, he went to Belize and offered George Price and his associates this vast amount of money to buy a chunk of what was known as the Mountain Pine Ridge in Belize, and they turned him down because what he was doing would have destroyed what was natural. And instead he went to Mr. Ludwig went to Brazil.
That's right.
And bought a big chunk of the Amazon forest, and I don't know what was the outcome of that project, but I know it wasn't good for Brazil, it wasn't good for the Amazon forest, which means it wasn't good for humanity, and ultimately, of course, as forests do, it swallowed up whatever money that would be poured into it, and then there's no trace of it.
Well, there was a film even made about that, and you're absolutely right. I want to take a moment to think about film, because you said something to me once that caught my mind. You said, you know, film's an extremely handmade thing, and when you talked about hotels, you said how, you know, hotels are also very similar to a movie production in your experience. You said there's the hospitality vision, the script, the guests, the audience, the staff, the cast, and the location, the set. How do those ideas and how have those ideas fit into your accidentally becoming a hotelier? Because you never set out purposely to do that.
No, you know, it's an interesting subject, but yes, that's very true. I when I made the film Godfather 2, it had six settings. There was a lake, a modern lake, a Lake Tahoe setting. There was a Las Vegas setting. There was an old New York 1920s setting. There was a Sicilian setting. There was a Havana setting during the Havana Revolution. So in a sense, the movie, it had a New York setting, it had an LA setting, and a Las Vegas setting, if I may. So it was like this movie with all these other parts. But I never was scratching my head saying, well, what part am I in? To me, they were just all part of the same movie, and I went from one to the other to do it. And that's sort of how I find in my life my relationship to storytelling and I'll call it show business or call it theater. I have, you know, my career, I've gone from thing to thing sort of just irresponsibly doing whatever I want. I didn't like get to be a movie director and then just stay being a movie director every year, making a movie like a sausage that goes out. I've always been interested in the bigger idea of storytelling or theater. I mean, after all, cinema is nothing more than an evolution of theater, which has been with us for thousands of years. And in thinking about that, I realized that all these activities that I've been involved in, seemingly irresponsibly in a way, the wine business, has all been a form of theater. It's all been a form of storytelling. And those of you who are in the wine business, certainly know that the wine business is largely the storytelling business. It's not that glass, that beverage that the people look at, that they enjoy the aroma, that they enjoy the flavors. Because without the story, it is just a beverage. But with the story of the families that went to those lands, be they in Europe or in the New World, such as South Africa or Argentina, where we are, which makes incredibly wonderful wine. The thing about Argentina wine that's different than Chilean wine and other wines, which are also, you know, fine wines, is that basically the Argentines are largely Italians, whereas Chileans are largely other peoples, Germans, Spanish, of course. But they were very good at marketing and commercializing wine, but the Argentine, they drank it, you know, because it was wonderful wine. And so they were very slow to begin to export it. And Argentine wine remains some of the best wine in the world, but, you know, it's a bargain. It's a great, great. When you're in a restaurant, you look at all the various wines, there's an Argentine wine on the list, buy it, because you're going to get a lot for your money. But my point is that it's the story of the people who came to those countries and found the land or even in the wonderful Bordeaux stories of the widow who was there and the young English adventurer who came and they fell in love and it became Chateau Palmer or whatever. So it's the story of the wine and the family and the struggle to. Because ultimately wine is agriculture and the struggle of, against nature to come up with this fantastic elixir that we enjoy so much with food. Without the story, I don't know that wine would be a very interesting business, but without the story, tourism or hotels wouldn't be interesting. Because as you say, indeed it's the same thing. It's a show. And the staff, the team is the cast, and the people who work in the gardens and who work so hard, they are the crew. And there is a vision. And like all theater, it's made up usually in all of these fields, be it wine, be it hotels, be it film, be it theater, any form of what we call show business. There are two aspects to it. There's the big concept. The big idea, and then there's a million details that support it. So when you go into the hotel, you may understand that this is a hotel devoted to, say, the traditions of this land and the culture of this land. But it's through the details that you get to really experience. It's sort of like the difference between strategy and tactics. And in a film, there might be all films have a big theme, the big picture, the big story. But you really enjoy it through the thousands of little memorable details, the line of dialogue, or the little moment, the way so-and-so looked at so-and-so. So it's this combination of details supporting a big theme that seems to be at the root of all storytelling. And storytelling is at the root of all of the various businesses that all of us are in, be it hotel business, be it tourism business, be it the cinema, be it the theater. Or the wine business, or the food business, or the restaurant business. It's all the same thing. It's all that basic human activity of telling a story with a big idea, big theme, and using a thousand memorable details to support it. So I found in my own life, this accidentally, you know, I basically, when I was younger, I recognized that you needed a lot of money to make the movie you wanted to make, because otherwise you were going around begging people to give you some money so you could make a film that might or might not ever make its money back. And so when I was younger, I thought, what I've got to do is I've got to have some money so I can just go make the film, so I don't go hat in hand and ask permission to do it. And I tried to make, I invested in this or I invested in that, and I always lost. And then I said, you know, I'm not going to even try to make money anymore. I'm just going to do everything that I love. And if I love wine, I'm going to just make wine and enjoy wine and make dinner for my friends, and like my grandfather did, and he had seven sons, and they made wine in their home because America had something which many of you will not be able to understand, which was prohibition, where it was illegal to have wine and make wine and spirits. Winston Churchill said, that's against civilization. but they did allow Italians, or since Americans are all immigrants, they did allow people from wine-drinking countries, you could make two barrels of wine in your home for your own table. And so I would hear, my grandfather had seven sons, so I heard these great stories of trying to steal the grapes, and but the kids didn't want the wine, they wanted the grapes, you know. So that's how I got into it, my point is I just started to do what I loved, and I made money. I don't know why. I don't. Maybe there is some magic that if you do what you love, you'll be lucky. I always tell you, young people are always being told by their parents, "No, don't study philosophy and be a novelist. Be an accountant first, and then when you have a living, then study philosophy and be a novelist." Or don't be an artist, be a teacher, or get an education degree. But that's the wrong thing to tell young people. You should tell people, young people, say, do what you love. Because by doing what you love, they're gonna know who they are. And the odds are that whatever they do that they love is gonna be very useful to them. My daughter Sophia said to me once, she's like, I don't know, maybe not even 20. She said, "Oh, Daddy, am I just a dilettante? I want to be a painter, I love to paint, and I like stories, and I like fashion photography, and am I just a dilettante?" And I said, "No, do everything you love, and eventually it will all be clear what it is you're meant to do." And I advise all of you who have young kids who are at that age where they're not sure what to do, tell them to do what they love, because by doing that, they are going to define who they are, and whatever it is they are, if they study for a while fashion, or if they study for a while journalism, believe me, it will all come together, as it did for Sophia. Who knew she was going to be a movie director, that writing stories and doing fashion and being a painter was all going to eventually contribute to what she was. So I guess what I'm saying at this ripe gray old age, as I come to you, because I see you all look pretty young to me, I must say, is that I did make a decision midway through my life to forget trying to make money and just do all the things that I loved. And that included winemaking, that included going off into the jungle. You know, when you make a movie in the jungle, as I did with Apocalypse Now in the Philippines, and famously, Lawrence of Arabia, David Lean, he fell so in love with the desert that when the movie was over, he couldn't leave. And I found that when Apocalypse Now was over, the jungle is a scary place, as I'm sure the desert is, but the jungle is also a very safe place. The jungle is a place where there might be a thorn that will kill you, but the same tree that has the thorn that will kill you has a leaf that if you eat it will cure you, which is why all medicine comes from the jungle. So I started to realize I love the jungle. I didn't want to leave the jungle. And I said to my wife, "Well, I want to buy a place in the jungle. She's my friend. She just bought a winery in Napa Valley. You have to get back there asking what they should do with the winery. Find a jungle that's closer to the winery. Because you're probably not going to get on a plane and go to the Philippines for 11 hours. So I said, "Oh, maybe you're right." So when I read in the paper that British Honduras, which was the part of Central America, was becoming Belize in 1981, I went with my son to find my own jungle. And that's how we found a place up in an abandoned place up in the mountains, and that's how I found myself in having a lodge and ultimately being in the hotel business. If you say yes enough, you'll be in the hotel business. That's the key. So I love my life. I love the fact that I stumbled along just basically doing the things that I was interested in, that I loved, telling my story along the way, whether it was in a film, whether it was in a hotel, whether it was in a wine. I prospered. And more wonderful of all, I ended up having children who are all, as you know, my daughter is a wonderful filmmaker, my granddaughter, that all my children have done what they love. And they seem to be prospering and be happy. So that's what I've learned, that this whole, the tourism business, the hotel business is another expression of storytelling. And storytelling is where we first uncover that mysterious word that you all want to know about, which is the brand. Because when do you first encounter your brand? It's when you're 4 years old and you go to kindergarten and you take the other kids, I'm Francis Coppola and my lucky number is 7. I already had, in kindergarten, I had a brand. I was Francie, and I was Francie, and my lucky number was 7 because I was born on April 7th. And I could tell stories. And so suddenly, the other kids liked me because I told lots of stories because I had read, I don't know how I could read, but I could, all the fairy tales. And I would tell them the story of Snow White and Rose Red and the Tinder Box and the Little Mermaid and what have you. So already I had my brand at age 5, and I had my profession. I was going to be a storyteller. And being a storyteller doesn't necessarily mean you can only make movies. You can also make wine. You can also make hotels. You can do everything that you bring a group of people together, and you have a big idea and give them all these wonderful details that you can possibly think of.
Francis, and ladies and gentlemen, I've learned, having the privilege to speak with this wonderful man. He calls Marlon Brando a genius. I think we can all agree we have a genius right here in the room. And I've learned that when he's talking, give him the chance to speak. And I don't want to interrupt you. We only have
interrupt me, give me a question.
Okay, no, we only have really just a few more minutes. But you touched, Francis, I can't tell you the wisdom, personally, the inspiration with what you just said. The idea of do what we love. Don't think about what we're going to make, this and that. Do what we love in our passion. We know that you and your family, your wife, your children, Roman with his screenwriting, have all gone on to do and be very, very successful. But I do want to come to one point, and that is this. As much as film has been a part of your life, travel has been a part of your life. You have traveled consistently with your kids from the youngest age. You've taken them all around the world. You shot a film in Buenos Aires in 2009 called Tetro. You loved a townhouse you were staying in. That's one of your hotels now. You told me a story once about how you were in Istanbul and you went out on a night of, I'll just say straight out, drinking with locals, came back, fell asleep, and got one of the ideas for your film, Twix, from a dream that came to you. So how much has travel been and played a role in inspiring your creativity?
Well, I mean, let's be frank, life is travel. When we live our lives, we don't sit in a room and then easy chair, we're out interacting within our culture, within our family. Who would be given this incredible opportunity to be alive and not go anywhere or interact with people? That's all it is. That's ultimately, and I like to think of, in that great mysterious moment coming up, we don't ever know when, but when you meet your maker, as they say, or when you confront death, I'm not going to sit there and say, gee, I wish I had done this, I wish I had done that, I wish I had done that. I'm going to say, oh, I got to do this, and I got to do that, and I got to be in the movie business, I got to see my kids be in the movie business, I got to be in the hotel business, and I got to go to Argentina and make a movie, and I got, I'm going to be so busy saying all the things I got to do that when I die, I'm not going to notice it. The irony is that what you said, the irony, and I don't know if this is some great cosmic joke, but if you do the things to love, the odds are you will make a lot of money too, for some strange reason. I don't even know what the logic of that is, but that is what has happened. That if maybe it makes sense, if you do the things that you really personally are involved in and motivated by, of course it's going to connect with other people. And isn't that what making money or having power or influence really is, that other people are attracted or somehow gives you 10 cents? You're going to have a lot of money, and so it makes sense that if you do the things you love.
Well, Francis, you have in this room the world's top leaders in the travel and tourism industry. I know with the words you just spoke and in previous conversations, I mean, and right now in particular, I feel like I've had a life coach session, and I take this to heart. What message do you have for the business leaders of the travel and tourism industry at a time when travel and tourism is growing rapidly? There's really no place left on the planet we can't go. We have every means to get there. How would you like travel to be for your grandchildren? You've always been a big family guy.
I had a rule in my family that if ever I was going to go away, because in the movie business or in any business, you have to go away for 2 weeks. I said, if I ever have to go away more than 2 weeks, I'm taking the kids out of school and taking them with us, because I knew very often 2 weeks turns into 14 weeks. And because I did that, and it's harder to do today than it was then, because now a lot of schools, when you go and say, we're taking the kids with us on a trip for 2 weeks, they put pressure, especially certain private schools that don't know, we don't allow that. But I'm so happy I did. It was tough on their academic careers, but what they saw, what they experienced is going to be part of them, and then the way that things work out of their children as well. I think what I would ask for out of travel, the thing about travel is assuming we're not going to other worlds right away, and I don't want to go anywhere that doesn't have trees. So all the kids say, oh, we're going to go to Mars. Well, you can go to Mars. There are no trees on Mars. I don't want to go to Mars. The trees are too wonderful to have to go anywhere where they are not. But at any rate, the fact that we are going to go through, people were traveling to France and England in the early 19th century, in the 18th century, in the 15th century. But each time we travel with a different mindset. So in a sense, it's a different journey. So what I hope for the future of my grandchildren, that yes, indeed, they go to this beautiful earth. But let's face it, all beauty of art, all beauty and everything, all comes from this planet. The beauty of art, of the artists who have done such beautiful things, all is inspired from what's here. This planet is so varied and so full of variation and beauty that what I would wish is that the next generation that traverses the deserts and the seas does it with their mind in a slightly more advanced place. So in a sense, it's a totally new journey. But isn't that the key to tourism even now? If you can invite your guests to come to where you are welcoming them, granted you could give them a wonderful experience, your staff could be just perfectly tuned, your ideas, your details, the amenities you give. Oh, forget the double sink, because no one brushes their teeth in the bathroom with the sink here and the sink there, and there's no place to put your stuff on the sink anymore. But instead of that, better to have the master bedroom have two bathrooms. That's my suggestion. But what I'm saying, aside from those little amenities, it all started with the chocolate bar that someone put on the pillow. My feeling is that you're inviting people to see this world with a different mental point of view. And by doing that, it's a whole new trip. And so that's what I wish for my grandchildren, that they see people and places and beauty and culture with more interest in what was really there. So it's really a mental trip. It's not like a movie when you think about it. I mean, all the movies that are made, pretty much you can look and say, well, this movie's really like that movie, this movie. But what's different? It's all the details and the mental attitude that the director gives you. So as they come to your places to visit, you're going to give them a different way of thinking. Ecotourism was that.
doing, trying to tour with the extraordinary food opportunities that there are. It's always a new mental adjustment. So that's where you get, the earth is only so big, but it becomes infinitely big when you change how you look at it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Francis Ford Coppola, a legendary filmmaker.